Please be seated. Good morning, everyone. Whether you're physically here or joining us via Zoom, welcome to you and a happy Easter day to you. Just to reinforce, there's nothing in the notices that we need to reinforce this week, but just a reminder that we no longer pass plates round for the offertory. There are plates at the front and at the rear of the church, and if you wish to make a donation to the church's funds, then please do so after the service. And we do welcome this morning Richard Beckett, who's leading our service today. We do ask the Lord's blessing on you, Richard, as you lead us in worship.
Thank you.
Thank you.
A very good morning to you and a happy Easter to everyone. I think some of you have been here some while already from the aroma that greeted me as I came into the building this morning. So this worship is a continuation, if you like, I guess, of the worship that you've already been taking part in as you've been eating and sharing together. So welcome to those of you at home too, or wherever you might be worshiping with us. And it's a good day to be worshiping together. We share in our opening prayer, and the words will be on the screen. If you'd like to respond with the words, Alleluia, I'll lead the rest. Christ is risen. Alleluia. The tomb is empty. Alleluia. God is with us and within us. Alleluia. We are an Easter people. Alleluia. Christ is risen. Alleluia. 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 Let's stand and sing our first hymn, Thine Be the Glory, Risen Conquering Son.
Thank you. we pray again. We'd like to respond with the words, "He is risen indeed. In the rising of the Easter dawn,
Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. In the laughter of children at play during a ceasefire, Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. Where the hungry celebrate with feasting, Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. Where people find their voices and sing their songs, Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. When enemies give up violence and become friends, Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. When love is allowed to flourish and grow into community, Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. We welcome you, our crucified and risen Christ. Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed." And we share together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Now, I need maybe two volunteers, somebody who's good at painting. It could be painting walls or it could be painting pictures, but you don't really need to have any skill at all to do this. You just need to be able to hold a paintbrush and maybe not make too much mess, but we're prepared if you do, so it doesn't matter that much. So just two people, they can be young people, older people, I don't mind. There's one volunteer in the middle there straight away, which is great. Come on then. And maybe one more as well. Would you like to come to the front? So I've got two paintbrushes. If there's one more. Yes, come on then. That's great. And I think we've got a volunteer to just hold the board for me. Would you like a large or a small paintbrush? Small? Large, okay. So this is really very easy. You don't have to do very much at all. All you have to do is cover the whole of this board with black paint. Okay? If you can't reach the top, that's not a problem. Somebody else will. Okay, so go for it. You can make a bit of mess, I don't mind, but somebody else will. But while you're doing that, I'm just going to talk, okay? Because this is really very simple and very straightforward. When we think about the Easter story, we know of people who tried to cover Jesus up. Do you know what I mean? You know, if we think about the soldiers who crucified Jesus, they tried to put Jesus down, they tried to cover him up. When Mary, the two Marys went to the tomb, they perhaps couldn't see Jesus because of the tears in their eyes. You know how that is? If you're crying, you can't always see very clearly. Those tears were in some way trying to conceal who Jesus was from them. There were others as well. There was Peter. You remember Peter, who was a good friend of Jesus, but denied that he knew him at the end of the day. And that denial tried in some way to cover Jesus up. When the soldiers nailed Jesus to the cross on Good Friday, they were trying to put him down and cover him up. Now, when we come to church, we know that Jesus is alive this day, but maybe sometimes through what we do or through our actions, through the wrong things we say or the things we don't say, we try in some way to cover Jesus up. Now, I don't know how are you doing? You doing okay? So I think as hard as you try, you shouldn't be able to cover Jesus. They're making the paper really nice and wet. You kind of, you almost expect it to drip off the great stuff. That's brilliant. Thank you. Job done and not too much mess. Thank you. Would you like to sit down there? Thank you. Brilliant. So let's pray, shall we, as we think about what's been happening here and as we come to church to worship the risen Christ. Gracious God, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we can celebrate the risen Jesus together. We thank you that in no way can we cover him up. In no way can we see him remained buried. And we rejoice because Jesus lives with us this day and every day. Amen. So I think we're going to sing again, and the hymn is See What a Morning. So our young people and children are going to leave us. I think they have some, well, quite interesting activities lined up. I heard something about an Easter egg hunt or something like that. So as we go, we're just going to pray for you. Thank you, God, for the enthusiasm and the joy that our young people bring to worship. We thank you for their enthusiasm. We thank you for the joy that they bring. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going to hear two readings this morning, both from Matthew's Gospel. The first one is Matthew chapter 27, verses 57 to 61. But just let me say something a moment before you read for me. This is focusing a little bit on Joseph of Arimathea. In John's Gospel, we read that Joseph was a secret disciple. Matthew, in his Gospel, says that Joseph was rich. Mark's Gospel tells that he was a counsellor and hadn't agreed to the decision that the rest of the governors had made about Jesus. Mark tells us that Joseph went boldly to Pilate to request Jesus' body. But something significant happened in the life of Joseph, and somehow he moved from a place of fear to strength. And that's quite important in our thinking this morning. But what we're going to hear now is that reading, and then that's going to be followed by, I guess, something which we'd call an imaginative drama based on a conversation between Joseph of Arimathea and his wife, if indeed he was married. We're not certain of that, but let's imagine for a moment what that might have been like. So the reading first, and then we're going to hear the drama. Thank you.
The burial of Jesus. When it was evening, a rich man from Arimathea arrived. His name was Joseph, and he also was a disciple of Jesus. He went into the presence of Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate gave orders for the body to be given to Joseph. So Joseph took it, wrapped it in a new linen sheet, and placed it in his own tomb, which he had just recently dug out of solid rock. Then he rolled a large stone across the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there facing the tomb. Amen.
How could you?
Well, I thought it was the right thing to do under the circumstances.
The right thing to do? To give away our family tomb to this what's-his-name from Nazareth?
His name's Jesus.
I don't care what his name is. What I do care about is you giving away our tomb, without telling me.
Well, I'm telling you now, aren't I?
Well, it's just a bit late now, isn't it?
So what was I supposed to do? Bring the body back here and say, what do you think about giving this chap a berth in the family tomb?
I just don't see why you had to get involved.
Because he needed a tomb.
We need a tomb.
Not as much as he does.
How come?
Because he's dead.
We'll be dead too someday. What are you going to do then?
Look, I'm sorry if I've upset you. But what's done is done. We can always get another tomb.
But that was a special one. It was a wedding present.
Only your mother will give us a tomb as a wedding present.
But that one... No, sorry, this next bit down. Don't talk about my mother in that tone of voice. It was very thoughtful of her.
I'm sure it was. Anyway... There's still plenty of room left.
Are you seriously suggesting that we still use it?
I don't see why not.
Over my dead body. That man was a common criminal.
Nonsense.
Then why was he executed?
On a trumped-up charge.
Don't tell me you've become one of his followers.
Well, I found lots of the things he said were very interesting.
Interesting? The man was clearly off his head. He said he was the Messiah.
Then perhaps he was the Messiah.
Then why couldn't he afford his own tomb?
Excuse me?
Yes?
I'm looking for Mr. and Mrs. Joseph of Arimathea.
Yes?
I'm from the Gethsemane Garden Maintenance Department, moved up here from Jericho. I now take care of the plot in front of your tomb. I'm afraid your account's overdue.
Typical. Full of grand gestures, but too busy to pay your bills.
I can pay the bills. I've got a cheque here. It's already written. All I've got to do is tear it out of the chequebook.
Carefully.
Pass it over.
Anyway, we won't be needing your services anymore.
Why? Are you not satisfied with us?
No, it's nothing to do with you. I'm quite satisfied with you. It's my husband I'm not satisfied with, giving away the tomb to a stranger.
Ah.
But it was such a nice tomb, don't you think?
As tombs go.
Ahem. I'm sure this gentleman's very busy.
Don't interrupt. What would you do?
Ask for it back, I suppose.
It's a bit late for that. He's dead already.
So, where is he now?
What do you mean? Where is he now? He's in the tomb.
In your tomb?
Doesn't anybody ever listen to a word I say? Of course he's in our tomb.
Well, I'm just asking because I didn't see him there this morning.
Well, you wouldn't have been able to see him because there's a great big rock across the entrance.
But there wasn't a rock across the entrance.
There must have been. I put it there.
I'm afraid there wasn't. And as far as I could see, the tomb looked pretty empty too. Now, if you'll excuse me, I really must be getting along.
Our tomb's empty again.
It must have been grave robbers.
Empty.
Grave robbers.
No. Nasty strangers cluttering it up.
I just don't understand how they managed to get past the guards.
Now, we can use it any time we like.
But he could hardly have let himself out, could he?
Our wedding tomb.
Could he?
It's got such a lovely view.
Thank you so much. Thank you for that. So we're going to hear a little bit more of the reading from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28 now, and verses 1 to 10.
After the Sabbath, a Sunday morning was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. Suddenly there was a violent earthquake. An angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled the stone away, and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid that they trembled and became like dead men. The angel spoke to the women. "You must not be afraid," he said. "I know you were looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has been raised, just as he said. Come here and see the place where he was lying. Go quickly now and tell his disciples. He has been raised from death, and now he is going to Galilee ahead of you. There you will see him. Remember what I have told you." So they left the tomb in a hurry, afraid and yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Peace be with you." They came up to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. "Do not be afraid," Jesus said to them. "Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Thanks be to God.
We come before God with a prayer of confession and then an assurance of forgiveness. Let's say the words together. We pray. We shout our alleluias, yet within us there are burdens of guilt and regret. There are words spoken and deeds done that ought not to have been. There are tasks of discipleship left undone. There is love not given, a smile not offered. There is rejection, denial, betrayal. On this Easter day, we confess our failings, and in resurrection life and light, seek forgiveness. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Amen. And hear these words for yourselves. Risen Christ, wipe away our fears and our tears. Cleanse us, renew us, refresh us. Release us from all that we have confessed, and let us walk with you, our resurrection God, knowing that our sins are forgiven. Amen. So I want to take as a theme, if you like, just the thinking about moving from fear to boldness, or from fear to joy. The main characters, of course, in our passage that we heard are the two Marys, Mary Magdalene and Mary, and they go to look at the tomb, so we're told. Now, they go to look at the tomb. This is how Matthew describes it in his gospel. He doesn't tell us why they went there, but obviously they needed to be there where Jesus was. But there's something almost sort of forlorn, if you like, about Matthew's description of the Mary's visit to the tomb. In their grief, where else would they go? They would expect to be as close to Jesus as they could be, and the tomb was the place that they knew where he was. So that was where they went. But this wasn't the first time that the two Marys had been at the tomb. You might have heard in the previous passage that the two Marys were there when the stone was rolled in front of the tomb by Joseph, and I guess Joseph had some help as well. But Matthew presents a very dramatic version of the story, and fear is something that's mentioned four times in the passage, in really what's a fairly short account. Let me just highlight the places where that is. Certainly the guards are fearful. They're hardened Roman soldiers who, just a short while before, were nailing Jesus to the cross, and yet here they become like dead men, white as sheets perhaps, and they fall to the ground. The women's fear is mentioned a couple of times in the passage. We imagine that they were fearful, and we certainly know that from the way that the angel says to them, "Do not be afraid." And as the angel instructs them, the women hurried away from the tomb and they meet Jesus. And now they're afraid again, and Jesus says to them, "Do not be afraid." And then we're told they have this mixture of fear and joy. Is that even possible? A mixture of fear and joy? And so imagine their shock when Jesus suddenly appears, and again they're fearful. And he sees their fear and says, "Do not be afraid. And now go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There you will see me." And I wonder too what the root of their fear was. Because when you're in a heightened state of grief, the slightest thing that happens can affect you, and things then become too much to bear. And I don't know whether that's been something of your experience. So imagine then what effect an earthquake would have on those two women. Was it the resurrection itself that made them fearful? But actually, the women don't see Jesus coming out of the tomb. They don't see him being resurrected as such. In fact, nobody in the Gospels do. What they see is the risen Christ. Maybe it was the presence of the angel. We'll talk a little bit more about the angel later. His appearance was described as being like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow, just as we would imagine an angel to be, perhaps. Is their fear based on the way in which the angel rolled the stone out of the way? It's another intrusion on their grief, surely. But the angel does not let Jesus out. I don't know whether you noticed that. The angel shows them that Jesus is not there. He's no longer in the tomb. And the angel invites them to come and see the place where Jesus was, where Jesus lay. So I wonder, just for a moment, if we could try to recall something of fear that's happened within our lives. I'll just share a couple of examples of my own. My dad was a great man. He died now in 2010. But I can remember an occasion when we sailed together on Poole Harbour. Now, I don't know whether anybody knows Poole Harbour. It's quite a big, open, well, it's not wild, but it can be at times. And I was 10 years old at the time, and we went out into this harbour in a sailing dinghy. And as I got into the boat, I thought, how does he know about all these ropes and this sheet that's there and these bits of wood? How does he know how they work? I had no idea whatsoever. And he said to me, sit there in the rear of the boat and hold on to the tiller. Well, I didn't have a clue what a tiller was, let alone what to do with it when I had hold of it. But as you might know, it's the bit that steers the boat, isn't it? And so I sat there in the tiller and held on to the, sat in the boat and held on to the tiller dutifully. And we went up and down Poole Harbour. I was quite scared, to be honest. I was quite fearful. I'd never been in a sailing boat before. I'd done rowing, yes, I'd been out rowing together. And it wasn't until later I discovered that my dad was a Sea Scout when he was younger, so he knew about sailing. But we went up and down Poole Harbour, and the wind slowly increased as we sailed. And we were going towards the end of the harbour, and I realised we're going to have to turn round at some point. Now, if you sailed, you would know what a complicated procedure turning a sailing boat round is. So we got to the end and he said to me, duck. He said, put your head down because this bit of wood up here is going to swing round and bash you on the head if you don't do that. So I did that and the boat tipped over. My fear, of course, was of drowning. I was 10 years old at the time. I had no fear at all, because the other thing he didn't tell me was that the water actually would only come up to my chest in the section of the harbour that we were in. There need have been no fear there, but you will all have your own experience of fear. Just for a moment, let's be quiet and think about that for yourselves, and then I'll share something else with you. So what are your greatest fears? And perhaps if we were in a more relaxed place, we could maybe have a conversation, but it's not. I'm not going to invite anybody to say, unless you really want to, talk about some moment of fear for yourself. But maybe you have fears for the world in which we live. Maybe you have, or a friend or a relative has, a health issue, and that brings you fear. Maybe you fear for another 5 years of governance by Donald Trump. We just have to be careful what we say, don't we? Maybe we fear for our own government and its place in our country and how that leadership is going to pan out over the next year. Maybe our fear is for climate change and the effects on our country, let alone countries which are developing in our world still. And sometimes it's very easy, isn't it, to say that Jesus' words will dispel our fears. Sometimes we have to think a little bit more than that. Yes, that is true. It certainly is true. But there are times when it might be necessary to identify our fear first. And in some way acknowledge what it is and how it affects us. We need perhaps to recognize it and name it, and in some way to hold it before God and lay it at the foot of the cross. Just change tack slightly. That's a sailing term, isn't it? Remember that in the Bible, angels are always agents of God's action. And I simply love that image, which is in Matthew's Gospel, in that passage we read, where the angel rolls the stone away and sits on top of it. Do you remember that? Can you just hold that image for a moment? The angel rolls the stone away and sits on top of it. And there's something very sort of maybe mischievous or defiant in that action. Do you know what I mean? I always imagine him sitting sort of cross-legged, if an angel could do such a thing, on top of the stone. It's almost as if God is saying to us, ha, there's nothing that can stop my purposes. Not the obstacles which people set in place, and not the fear which could stop you moving forward. And Paul sums it up really well in Romans chapter 8 when he says, no, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. A stone rolled across the entrance to a tomb is a trifling thing. Note also that the women don't only overcome their fear and are so transformed by Jesus' appearance, but they also seem to forget who they are. It's worth just remembering for a moment that women counted for little in the Jewish and Greco-Roman times. They were treated as nobodies. They were sometimes treated as goods and chattels. They could, in some circumstances, be sold. They couldn't bear witness in a court of law, and yet God chooses them to be the first witnesses of Jesus' resurrection. So not only is their fear overcome, but now they're sent out to find the disciples and tell them where to go. Can you imagine how ridiculous that would seem to them? Here they are setting out on the journey, telling the disciples where to go and what to do. Fear overcomes society's rules of prejudice rewritten. But these are really only two of the outcomes of the resurrection. Because as we meet the risen Christ today, Christ transforms us into a people who go. As we meet the risen Christ today, he transforms us into people who will tell others. Meeting the risen Christ transforms us into people who truly worship. And meeting the risen Christ transforms us into a people who truly live without fear. Let's just be quiet for a moment. Go, tell, worship, and live. We're going to sing. The song I've chosen is, well, it's quite an old one, and I'm not sure whether people will remember it, but I suggest there may be a few people here a bit older than me, so you may well remember it. God sent his son, his name was Jesus. Would you like to play it through for us just before to remind us of the tune? I think you'll see why I've chosen it, though. The words fit in, I think, really well with our thinking about moving from fear to joy. So we come to God with our prayers for ourselves and for other people. If you'd like to respond to the prayers with the words, "Gracious God, move your world from fear to joy." Gracious God, move your world from fear to joy. We pray for the many people who live in fear of their lives from bomb and gun or oppressive government. Gracious God, move your world from fear to joy. We pray for the people who seek release from fear because of physical or mental health issues. Gracious God, move your world from fear to joy. We pray for all people who suffer as a result of abuse or neglect. Gracious God, move your world from fear to joy. We pray for people who are struggling financially, whose homes and family life are under threat, or are already homeless because of economic burdens. Gracious God, move your world from fear to joy. We pray for the leadership of countries and nations, that they will be courageous in their search for the truth and govern with integrity. Gracious God, move your world from fear to joy. And Lord, as we think about our own community of our church and our families and our friends, we bring before you those we pray for especially today. We pray for Ben and Matt as they mourn the death of their father this week. For others known to us, and we remember them in a moment or two of silence. And we pray for ourselves that we would be your servants in all we do. We ask that the new life of the season would be seen in us at home, at school, at work, and in our communities. May we all know and share the peace and hope of Jesus. Gracious God, move your world from fear to joy. Amen. So the singing group are going to share a song with us, Led Like a Lamb to the Slaughter. And you'll notice that you have some tiny angels in front of you on the pews. There should be enough for one each, I think. If there are some scattered where you're not sitting, then perhaps you'd just like to pass those along. On the back, there's a piece of double-sided tape. And I'm going to invite you to, during the song, to come to the board at the front and stick them on a picture of a stone that we'll have on the board as a symbol of the way in which we see God's agent, as the angel, if you like, overcoming our fear and maybe in our prayers the fears of the world. So just something for you to do, if you invite you to do that, if you feel comfortable and able to do that, just come to the front as the music group are singing, place your angel on the stone as a sign of the way in which God conquers our fear. Thank you. So we're going to share a song together, and I think the music group are inviting you to sing the chorus. So maybe we'll stand, because I feel more comfortable singing when I'm standing. And would you like to play it through us? Play it for us, and then we'll join in the chorus. A blessing to close our worship this morning. The risen Christ meets us as we leave this place. The risen Christ meets us in this place. He meets us in the smile of a friend, in the less good behaviour of an enemy. The risen Christ meets us in our life, in our death, in our outgoing from here. In Jesus' name, we are blessed, and you are blessed. Amen.
Amen.
Would you like to sing that for us again? Would you like to do that? Please, we'd really love that. And we'll join in with you this time.
Ourselves could not be raised. But now it's a chance for one lucky adult to win an Easter egg. There were 28 correct answers to the Easter quiz. They're in this hat. Okay. One will be drawn out. Now is the time.
Sorry.
Linda, come on. Come and do the drawing. Yes, please.
I can't find her. Hang on.
And he's not here. The answer, the correct one, is Richard Lovesey. Oh, you've moved to the back. Well, Dawn, would you like to come and have the Easter egg? So there you are. Thank you very much, folks. Now you can have your tea.
Thank you.
minute.